Today is a very special day to our family. Warm Mazel Tov to our daughter Ayala Hana and soon to be husband Eliyahu Dolev for their upcoming wedding made together. The enjoy of building Beit Ne'eman B'Yisrael, a house of Torah lives and Yirat Shamayim. And may they and we enjoy Nachat, a joy and happiness for the future generation. Amen.
Amen.
We are on page 26 of the Mishnah. וכולם שהיו להם נשים ומתו מותרים להינשא להם. The subject of yesterday was the idea that people who involve in a manner of get, for example, the shaliach, the emissary, who transmitted the get from overseas, as well as the sage that could not abrogate the act of vow of the woman, or a witness that come and testify before the court, the rabbinic court, the husband is no longer among the living. We explained earlier that those entities are prohibited to marry those that they inform in concern, which we call chashad. We're concerned that it may be some type of personal desire to have those women as a wife, and therefore they involve by doing those actions, such as bringing the get, such as reporting the death of the husband, etc. So as much as we're accepting that in a face value, those individuals that involve with this are basically excluded from marry those whom they report. Now, we make here some modification. In a sense, we said, וכולם, in all these cases of these men, all these list, שהיו להם נשים, if they had wives at the time of the incidents, and the wives later died, we allow them to marry them because we have the assumption that they don't do it out of motivation to have them as a wife. Even the time of the Talmud, it was incidences of men that marry more than one, we have the assumption, that's the way Aruch Laner explained to us in Rashi, that people don't do that in a matter of average day. People don't do that, especially since at the matter of that incident they married. We have the assume that that they don't do that. Yet we must remember also what the Nemukei Yosef and Yerushalmi tells us, that if the wife of that person, let's say if it was a sage that have issue of annulment of her vow, or the shaliach, the emissary that transmit the get, or the person that brought upon us the sad news that the husband is no longer among the living, if their wives were very ill at that time, then again we're back to square one and they are prohibited to marry that woman. וכולן, but here it's a situation we call מצב ביניים, here's in between, שנישאו לאחרים ונתגרשו או שנתאלמנו, מותרות להינשא להם. Which means if those women later married out for other people, with to other people, and then much later they divorced their husband, became widows, so now it's already the second one. If you speak about the original shaliach, for example, that transmitted the get, we do not have the assumption that he did it in order to marry her, since it was another man in her life in between. Similar halacha, וכולן מותרות לבניהם או לאחיהם. And all of these cases of women are permitted to the sons and brothers of this man, because we do not have the suspicion that they did it in order to have their relatives marry them. So it means to involve with knunia, to make such a clandestine plan in order to have an act of znut, this is something that it's in a way far-fetched. So the Gemara said, so in other words, a person can commit a sin for himself, but if it's come to a distance for relatives, we don't go there. Now, the Gemara said, metu en nidgarshu lo. So we understand from the Mishnah that if a person come and witness that the husband is no longer among the living, so therefore, if those wives die, which means their husbands may marry the woman they helped free, but if the wives were divorced, no, the husband may not marry these women, because again, people will say that they divorced the wife in order to marry these women. Amar le-Rav Hillel le-Rav Ashi, ve-Atanya afilu nitgarshu. But we learn in the Braita that even they divorced from their wife, the woman allowed to marry those. So they said, Lokashi ahad de havai ktata, had de lo havai ktata. Basically, here we speak about situation that it was some involved with the fights earlier, which is the idea that, again, it go either way, that either they have some argument earlier, and this was the pretext to go ahead and do that. That's the Ritva, and the Meiri said that it was later. This is, the argument happened later, so it means that that's not the proof that that's led them to that. V'ibayitema is another avenue. Ha v'ha de'lo havai k'tata. In both cases, it wasn't any argument. V'lo kashya ha de'argilhu ha de'argilahi. The first one is that he's the one who caused it, that because of that they divorce. Since he's the cause of that, we suspect that he planted, set up that plan in order to divorce her. And the other said, no, that she's the one who caused that argument, and since he is not the one who caused that, so people not suspecting him that he caused to marry her. Vechulam. And all these categories, the Mishnah said, of those women, meaning the one that the Shaliach, the emissary, brought the get from overseas, the one who testified that the husband is dead, and the one who couldn't find an annulment for the vow, shen nisu, and all of them, if they got married, so they allowed to go ahead and marry to those who originally reported, kasal galatach mita mita, gerushin agerushin, which means you go in the same manner in both ways, meaning that the Mishnah case of the dead, the woman widow from her second husband, is stated with regard to the previous Mishnah that the witness would testify regarding the death of the woman husband. And the same apply with the issue of gerushin, of divorce, the agent to bring the get from abroad and the sage who caused the divorce. So you match the same way. So neima matnitin de lo kerevi. The Ike Rebbe Amar Bitrei Zimnei Havei Chazaka. Rebbe said that when you have a legal presumption, it means if it happens three, you have two occurrences. So therefore, if you have several times, you don't say that it's just by coincidence, you say that it's a cause. So therefore, women that become widow twice, we assume that maybe it happens again. Women that divorce twice, we assume that it's possibility that she's going to divorce again. So therefore, we have an issue with that. So, in general, we should know that there's a concept called Isha Katlanit. Isha Katlanit, by the Talmudic concept, is a woman that several husbands passed away. So we basically have an issue with her marrying the man. because if it happens once, okay, but if it reoccur, we have issues. So there is an unbelievable, fascinating Tshuvot HaRosh, the responsa of Rabbeinu Asher. He explained, and again, this is a little vignette of Kabbalah, but it's something to think about. He said, we believe that there is a court above us. And if from Shamayim, from heaven, they put a decree for a certain person, for example, certain woman, that she will be in poverty state, God forbid. So she had a husband, he bringing a living. So any husband, he called it, kol baal shemegia lechaye amet, any husband that come to the picture of her life, he passed. Why? Because they in heaven, they make sure that this woman will not have income. So therefore, that's what Tos, if the Tshuvat HaRosh did not say it, I'll be afraid to say it, but he said it. So anyway, law, the Gemara rejected, and he said, Mita Agerushin, Gerushin Amita. Said, our Mishnah case of death is perhaps stated with regard to the previous Mishnah case of divorce, and the Mishnah case of divorce in regard to the Mishnah case of death. So here, that when the Mishnah said that the women that divorce or become widows from the second husband, they're allowed to marry from those who allow them to go ahead and marry from after the first husband. For example, a person who claimed that their husband is dead, he released that woman and she married another person, and now the second person is passed. So we hold that she can go ahead and marry the shaliach, the person that informed of the passing of the first husband. So that's not apply to a widow from two husbands or divorce from two. Why? Because if it's reoccur twice, we hold that now she prohibited in the third. So they have to say that the Mishnah intend to say that the woman that become widow from the first husband and then she divorced the second husband, or if she divorced from the first husband and then she become widow from the second husband, she allowed to marry to someone who annul her first marriage because it wasn't the same occurrence twice. Only one time divorce, one time widow, or one time widow, one time divorced. Then the Mishnah said, Vechulan, and all these examples, Mutarot livneihem o leacheihem, they allowed to go ahead and marry the sons or the brothers of the men who were instrumental in freeing them. So they said, Mishnah de'ad me'ad itlan en tamin ha'isha, asur b'imah b'mitah v'achotah. So wait a second. What we said earlier, if you remember yesterday, we said if someone is suspected that is a rumor about a man that he has something to do with certain women, now we said the opposite. We said that all of a sudden he allowed to go ahead and marry her mother or her daughter or her sister. Why here they allow and over there not? So they said Nashim legabei nashi shchichan ve'azlan, gavrei legabei gavrei lo shchichan. Say, to me, it's a fascinating thought that the rabbis understand the psychological element involved with this. They said when a woman, if she knows that the husband involved with relation with something close in her family, she, in a way, let go or more lenient than other cases, versus men, with the men, it's not common that to go and visit other men. So therefore, after her marriage, the woman married to the relative of one who has freed her, is not likely to have further contact with him. Another option, inami, nashei delo asran shchivatan ha'adadei, lo kap de ha'adadei. Okay, the women, they, in a sense, if they go with married men, they do not cause those married men to be prohibited to their husbands. So in a sense, they don't look all the times where he is going. That's the way Rashi said. Based on Mishnah and Kiddushin 80, in a sense, not everyone will understand, but it was some type of agreement that she will not be makpid, she will not go after him if he is going to another woman. But since if it happens that this relation prohibited her to her husband, then we have an issue, meaning married men who go to a woman who is single, it's huge different than a married woman who goes with anybody. So that's the concept. So Gavan de Asram Shchivtan Ahadadi, Kav de Ahadadi. So here, if we talk about a situation that the son is aware that is a potential for his wife to go out with his father, so he goes and is very careful when they are contact to each other, and he removes her from his life if anything happened like that. So we have no concerns, meaning our concern is if we see a potential to act of illicit or immoral relations. Something that it's a little far, we not go there. So he asked if that's the case. So the Mishnah also permit to marry his father. Why does the Mishnah limit the permit to the son and the brother? So they said, Lo mi baya kama, lo mi baya aviv de bziz binaminei, because he is the one who caused to have the heter, so he is embarrassed from his father. Aval bno, de lo bziz minei, because the father or the brother is caused to make this heter, so he's not have any act of fear or embarrassment from him. Eimalo, kamash melan, so the Mishnah teach us that she may indeed marry the son. Adran alach, keitzad eshet achim. Perek shlishi, this is Mishnah that we studied already several times. Arba'a achim, שניים מהם נשואים שתי אחיות, ומתו הנשואים את האחיות, הרי אלו חולצות ולא מתייבמות. ראובן, שמעון, לוי, and יהודה, four brothers. ראובן and שמעון is no longer among the living, but originally they married Rachel and Leah, okay? And now, since ראובן and שמעון died childless, Rachel and Leah goes before the other two brothers. So therefore, they have to do chalitza and not yibum. Obviously, the reason is because it's the concept of zika, yesh zika, which means each one of them is considering achod zkuka Torah, she explained, which is according to rabbinic law, it's the sister of his wife, and therefore you have only chalitza and not yibum. Tosfot yeshenim, add to that, and he said that's based on Rashi and Tosfot. He asked a question, why one of them will not do act of chalitza, and therefore the second one can do yibum? Why? Because the moment the one brother do chalitza, then for the zikah ban is over, and then the second one can do yibum. So Tosfot, if you remember, we studied it earlier, explained to us that because maybe if you know that, yavo kodem liyabem, he'll go ahead and do yibum first, and then chalitza. And the Rashi tells us earlier, since we talk here about Eshet Ach, the wife of the brother, so originally she's not nofelet liyibum, she's not go before the levirate marriage, so therefore le'olam lo chazer aleha, dinilum, she will never be able to be any act of levirate marriage, because the moment that you have concept of eshet ach, eshet ach is prohibited olamit, and therefore it's over. So these two svarot, two avenues, appear in Tosfot Yeshenim, and it's based what we already study in Rashi in Tosfot, and that was also what we see lekaman in the future in the Gemara.
Does each of the brothers, the surviving brothers, have zikaman to both the sisters?
That's the point. And since
right, they have a bond to both, so they're, so it's like in a way it's like marriage. So
yes, but those for the Shanim ask, how about if one of them does chalitza?
Yeah, but then the other brothers still have a zikaman with both of them.
But the point is, if she releases
by the one brother, then the other brother still has a zika bond to both of them, no?
Yeah, but if one brother released her, he does chalitza.
Right.
Then the other brother can do chalitza, the second one, and do yibum to the first one. That's Tosfot Yeshenim question. And he said the moment originally, that's based on Rashi in Tosfot, that it was a manner of achod skukato, which is eshetach, which is arayot, even it's the concept of rabbinic, then it's olamit, then it's for everlasting, she prohibited. So the trick here to think that one brother do chalitza and the other brother can go ahead and do yibum since he does chalitza is not going to work here. That's what Tosfot Yeshenim said. Anyway, afilu b'dieved, because since it you have here which called isu achod zkuka, so that's forever. So those two sisters, the moment, let me explain it in another phase. The moment that there are two originally have the concept of Eshet Ach, the wife of the brother, so even one of them is out, but since originally it was Eshet Ach, that by rabbinic rules, it's already excluded any potential act of Yibum. Now, Rabbi Eliezer Omer, that's Tosfot Yeshenim. Rabbi Eliezer Omer, Beit Shammai Omerim, Yekayimu, but Beit Shammai Yotziu. Beit Shammai said, okay, but the Avad, by force of circumstance, if one of the brothers did an act in a manner of levirate, so it's in action, it's okay. The other one, Beit Hillel said, no, it's out, can't do that. Now we bring the source. Hayta achat mehem asura la'echad. Let's say if Rachel, she was prohibited to one of the brothers, which means Levi, be'isur erva. Why? Because Rachel and Leah are the wives of Reuven and Shimon. And since the wife of Reuven and Shimon, they are noflim le'yibum before whom? Before Levi and Judah. So since she is one of the arayot, arayot can be achoto, his sister, can be chamoto, his mother-in-law, to Levi, only one of them nofelet liyibu. And the second brother, chozer adin. So therefore, you have two sisters, which is achot zkukato. And therefore, you have to go by chalitza and not be yibu. So therefore, asur ba, he is prohibited to her. Umutar ba'achotah elau, ne'achotah. So Rashi explained, since Rachel is considered erva to Levi, so she cannot have the yibum. So it means Leah is not achot zkuka of Levi, so therefore he can then act in levirate marriage. Ve'hasheni, which is Yehuda, he doesn't have the isu, so he have the asur bishneihem, because neither one of them is not erva to Yehuda, so both of them zkukot lo, so therefore each of them became achot zkukato, and therefore he only choletz, both of them are prohibited to him. Isu mitzalva v'isu kedusha, if Rachel was prohibited to Levi by mitzvah, which ze chayavei lavin de rabbanan, or because of sanctity. So now, which means that is a shniot la'arayot to Levi, So that's rabbinic, or it's love that is no karev. So choletzet velo mityabemet. Or the rif said cholzot velo mityabmot. Another incident, this called Hatzlava in Hebrew. הייתה אחת מהם אסורה על זה באיסור ערווה. If one of the sisters, for example, for our discussion is Rachel, prohibited to Levi באיסור ערווה. What is the איסור ערווה? For example, if this is חמותו, if his mother-in-law. והשנייה, אם לאה, אסורה על זה, אני יודע, באיסור ערווה. For example, קלתו, for our incident. Such as Rachel was mother-in-law of Levi, and Leah was mother-in-law of Yehuda, which means each of the sisters zkuka to that Yavam that is not a relative of her. Ha'asura laze muteret laze. The one who is forbidden to this one is permitted to that one. Ve'asura laze muteret laze. So later the Gemara in 28b explained why the Mishnah wants to tell us this, and he said וזוי שאמרו אחותה כשהיא יבימתה או חולצת או מתייבמת, since each of them נופלת only one of the sisters, so since she's the sister, so it's ערווה, so she's the only one who נופלת, and therefore she can do ייבום. So the Gemara said, Shma Mina, what you derive from all of that? You have to say that Yesh Zika, which means you have a Zika bond between the Yavam and Yavama. So I explain in my book, Biurei HaKlomar Berashi Al HaShas. Rashi tells us here, Klomar Chomrat Zika Leshavuyei Achot Zkukato Keachot Ishto. So in that sense, yeah, the thing that bothers Rashi based on the Gemara Nedarim 74 is how you conceptualize the Zika. Let's talk for a moment about Zika. They are not married yet, but as far as annulment of vows, he has the authority to abrogate it, to expunge her vows. So let's think together. You have here a widow that she is in a Zika bond to the surviving brother. They're not married yet, but if she made a vow, he can annul her vow. That's the point. So here, when it's come, which we call Chumrat Zika, how far you go with the Zika bond between them, that's basically the point that Rashi disturbed here, to understand when the Gemara used the term Yesh Zika. That's the way I understand Rashi. Anyway, so just the whole idea of Nedarim 74 is the idea that since the Torah said that the husband can annul a vow of a wife, and since you tell me that it is the concept of Zika bond between them, therefore he can go ahead and annul a vow. So if you tell me that, then it's already strong, the E and Zika. Because if you tell me that it's no such a thing as Zika bond in this case, Mikdei Hani Mitrei Batei Ka'atyan, why do you care that they are two sisters? Because since they're not the same house. Ha'ile Abem Chada, Ha'ile Abem Chada. Oh, so here you have Raya of a proof that it is a Zika. So the Gemara said, Le'olam Eimalach Ein Zika. You must say that it's no such a thing as Zika bond. משום דקסבר אסור לבטל מצוות יבמים. That's what we explain in page 17, if you remember, the Torah tells us there's a mitzvah to do yibum. So if you allow one of the brothers to do yibum of one of the sisters, so therefore the mitzvah of yibum will be automatically abrogated from the other one. דילמה על דמייבם חד מה יאיתך ומבטל מצוות יבמים. Sing together. Reuven, Shimon, Levi. Okay, let's say Levi come ahead, go ahead, and he act in Yibum to Rachel. Now, meanwhile, Leah, she needs to have the Yibum with Yehuda. If Yehuda passed away in a time in between, so now for Levi, she is the sister, Achot Ishto, the sister of his wife. So if he married Rachel, he basically mevatel mitzvat yevamin, he annulled the mitzvah of yevamin, mitzvat yevamin, that this is basically a special chumrah. That's the way Minchat Chinuch explained here. Because if Levi do only act of chalitza to Rachel, so you have here Le'ah midoraita, she can do an act of yibum because she is achot chalutza. Achot chalutza is only midrabona. So ach can do chalitza to achayot. So I saw in the Sochotshov, here in Israel you have these gemaras with the explanation, it's called Sochotshov, a special series of gemaras in Hebrew with the explanation. So they brought Rabbi Aizel Khalif, which is one of the luminary sages in the first generation. So he said, don't think, unlike the way we thought in page 17, that the only act of Yibum, Rabbi Aizel Khalif said, applies to Nefesh Hamet, to redeem the soul of the deceased. He says, Chalitzatu, it's Inyan Nefesh Hamet, even Chalitza. He said, it's a person who does that, the brother, it's Mekayem Ilui, V'tikun nefesh hamet, he helped the neshama, Le'ber Aliyah, and he helped the act of repairing the soul of the deceased. So the mitzvah of Yibum, we all know that he's lacking shem, that's the Torah said. But here, if he does not do it, and if she's not released, so basically Rabbi Aizel Khalif said, she is aguna, she is a deserted wife. Because in our mindset, that's so beautiful. He said, you know what, chalitza, in that sense, it's the same as Gerushin. What does that mean? He call it Hafka'at HaKesher. You annul, you abrogate, you expunge the potential of any bond between these two. So, here is the question. He asked there, how are you doing with elderly couple? Let's say you have two seniors. She is, let's say, 85 and he's 90. They don't even think about marriage, right? Do you tell him to do chalitza to her or not? Why? Because the whole echetimtze, the whole idea that we, if you allow her to do chalitza, she can go ahead and marry out. It's meaningless. Why? Because you don't have any hakamat nefesh amet. She cannot have children. So here, the Sochotshov brought from this Rabbi Aizel Khalif, he said that you have a ra'ayah kfula, you have a double proof that chalitza is necessary to not only to hatara lashuk, to allow her to marry outside, because if he married someone and her, the sister of the wife, she is muteret lashuk, so basically you do afka'ah, and bechrach, you have to say that chalitza is a mitzvah, because it's all involved in hakamat Hashem. So, in that sense, he said, from this Gemara, Rabbi Aizel Khalif hold that this is the proof that it's better, adif chalitza lishnaim, that you have the act of chalitza for both, from yibum le'echad. And the second one, teitze b'lo chlum. It's a famous story about Rabbi Aryeh Levin, the Sochotshov brought this story, it's a fascinating story. Anyway, I saw also in the Cheshek Shlomo, it's a story, it was a great rabbi by the name of Noach Shimonovitz, was a great rabbi in the past generation. So those days, we are back at the early 50s, the newly state of Israel. So he passed without children, and he has only one brother who lives in Russia. So imagine, at that time, the great communism, they have Russian council in Yerushalayim. So now they approach the whole idea of doing chalitza in Russia for the brother, right? The brother need to do So they went to Rav Herzog. Rav Herzog was the chief rabbi of Israel, the former president of Israel, late president. That was his father, Rav Herzog. And Rav Herzog turned the world upside down to go to this Russian council and try to convince them that they should do the act of chalitza, etc., etc. So these Russians are smart people, you know, this is not a Western. And the people in the council, in the Russian council, they did a big homework. So he sent that the rab to him. So the guy in the council, I don't know if it's the council himself or what, he says, oh, what do you think? You have Israeli citizen that go to spit before a Russian citizen? That's unacceptable. So he said, it's irrational. I learned your rules, and you're going to tell me that I'm going to prove that he will fly and spit, and it's that she's going to fly and spit on the face of a Russian man. That's not going to. So the rabbi came in and he says, look, I need to explain to you the concept a little deeper. He says, the mindset of the Torah is that the woman, the moment she's married, she has a very strong bond with her husband. And therefore, it's in her head all the time. No matter what, even if it's no longer among the living, it's still, you can talk with women that divorced, they're still talking about the ex. So in that sense, it's still in her brain. So the Torah come to that mindset of that woman. And the Torah tells us, you know what? If she spit on the face of the brother, that caused her to go over that. Now she can open a new chapter, definitely new chapter in her life. That will be out of her picture, total out of picture. And the ambassador or the council, whatever in Russia, said, oh, that makes a lot of sense. He said, all right, I allow it. Anyway, I want to mention to you the Cheshek Shlomo. The Cheshek Shlomo is a very prominent book. And he said that there are two reasons for here. Number one is the concept of Yesh Zika. That there is the Zika bond between the two. Number two, Shema Tidbatel Mitzvah Yibum, that we don't want to abrogate the great mitzvah of acting levirate matter. So he asked a fascinating question. So what do you do with the two brother, how do you call it, mute, that cannot speak? Yeah. Two brothers that mute. He says, when it's come to Yibum, you don't have a question. Because in Yibum, you don't need to speak. But when it's come to Chalitza, he need to speak. He need to say, Lo chafatzti lekachta. I'm not interested to take her as a wife. So if you tell me that it's Yesh Zika, so nothing will help. Lo yazor klum. You can't do anything because she remained aguna, deserted wife for forever. Now, if it's Achod Zkukato, and therefore, you cannot have a chalitza. But if you tell me that the whole concept is bitul mitzvat chalitza, so therefore you can do a yibum for both. That's the Cheshek Shlomo. Anyway, so the Gemara asks, if you tell me that the reason for the Mishnah is because we cannot annul, abrogate the mitzvah of yibum, why the Mishnah mentioned the circumstance of four brothers, Tlatanami. So Rashi explained to us, if it was three brothers, now you have a total zika. Why is total zika? Because if two of them marry two sisters, Rashi said, so therefore it's only one brother, right? Because if one of them do yibum, so the second one lost the potential of yibum. And automatically she is prohibited to him because it's a chot isha, right? So so since that applies to three brothers, why the Mishnah mentioned four? Remember that those, all of that come from the school of thought that it's Yesh Zika. So it is a Zika bond. So the Gemara responded and said, Lo mi baya kama kamina. The Mishnah state the ruling in its unnecessary as follows. Lo mi baya klata. You don't need to say that originally it was three brothers and two of them pairs that married to two sisters, that the third one cannot do yibum to neither one of them. Why? The vadai batla mitzvat yevamim, because the minutes that it does yibum, the second one automatically is no longer applied the mitzvah of yibum for the other one. Aval arba. But if you have two yevamim, if there's two, four brothers, lemita lo chayshinan. So because if this one of them can do yibum, And if the second one not pass, he also can do Yibum. Kamashman answers, the Tana therefore inform us that even the case that they may not perform a Yibum, because we do need to be concerned for the possibility of death, so therefore, we said, you have to go, that it's the way that they, also the Rashba said, that if it's a two Yibamim, you don't have a concern of Bitul the Mitzvah. So Gemara said, if you're concerned about the Yibam death, 26b, Chamisha Name. If you have two or five brothers that married two sisters, and they passed, and the two sisters now have the manner of Yibum before three brothers, so if we concern for the death, you should prohibit the Yibum even in that circumstance, because maybe after one of them act in a manner of Yibum, the other two brothers passed. So they said, Lemita de Trelo Hashim, that's too far. And the death of the two brothers, it's rachok, it's too far. Which means, according to that view, that the reason it's because bitul mitzvat yevamin, that we are not negation of the mitzvah of Yibum, when the two sisters are left as the widows of two childless brothers, Yibum is forbidden, whether there was one Yibam or two Yibam. However, it's permitted if there are three Yibamim. Now the Gemara goes to a total new subject, that relate to the several sisters to several brothers. Amar Rabah, or some say Rabah, Baravun Amaram, Shalosh Achayot Yevamot. Three sisters marry three brothers, which means they're all sister-in-law, since they're married to three brothers. Shenafnu naflu lifnei shnei achim Yevamim. So again, I'm using here my book, here Rashi, said klomar shnei achei ba'aleihen she'em yevamim. So Rashi have an issue here with the idea achim yevamim. It's like achayot yevamot, which means Rashi said that achiv yevamim, it means that these two brothers that basically have the mitzvah of three yibum, of three sisters, you can separate each case independently. And that's the reason, according to what I understand, the Gemara used this term, Shnei Achei Ba'aleihen Shehem Yevameihem, because each of them is individual. So they said, basically, the Cholzot, the Dinat Mitimot, now we have a big Chidush. Ze Choletz Le'achat, Veze Choletz Le'achat, Ruven, act of Chalitza to one, and Shimon, Chalitza to one, and Tzait, the third one, Tzricha Chalitza Mishnehem. She need to have the Chalitza from both. So Tosfot, Dibu Amatchil Nafla, tells us that she called Emtzait, she called Middle, according to Rashi, is not necessary, because as long as one of them did Chalitza, but according to Tosfot, she called Emtzait, because unlike the first ones, that each of them have Chalitza from one brother, she needs Chalitza from both. So since she needs from both, she called Emtzait, but that's not a usual matter, because basically in a regular way, if you have Chalitza of one of the brothers, it's already exempting the Rama from all of them. But later the Gemara explains the reason for that. Amar Lei Rabah, he said to Rabba Baravuna, Mi deke amart, because you tell me, Emtzait tzricha chalitza mishnehem, the middle sister require chalitza from both. So again, Rashi tells us here, there's a two-time klomar here. Rashi said, klomar shlishit velav davka nakat. So, because we use the term emtzait, you meant to say that it has to be bedavka, specifically that way. Beginning the first one, do for the oldest one, or the first one from the marriage, and then, so Rashi came and said, no. Here, it's lav davka emtzait, but whoever that come to be the last one. So he said, "Kasavart tzricha litza mishnehem." So Rashi said this several times, klomar. So number one, it's Rashi opposed to Tosfot, and number two, he explained basically based on the Rambam. And in the Perek Zayin, Rachatet, Ilchot, Ilchot, Bum, Bechalitza, and Sosho, Shukhano, Chorachayim, Kufayim. So in any case that the person cannot do Ibum, the Yevama is exempt totally from Chalitza, and if he does Chalitza, it's possible. But Tosfot didn't agree with that. So again, I recommend, since it's a lot of writing and we showed in time, you're welcome to read more on that in my book. Anyway, כסברתי יש זיקה הבלי חליצה פסולה, which is חליצה גרועה, וחליצה פסולה צריך לחזור על כל האחים, that each of them need to do חליצה independently, I see that we have to rush. יחי כמיה תנמי, also the first two sisters need to have חליצה from each of the brother. So he said, "Eid nafur, if all of them come and do it bevat achat, which means that all of them come and do chalitza together." So Rashi said, "Klomar em ba'u lachlotz ke'achat." So the big point here again, read more, is how exactly it happened. If it was in a subsequent order, or it the all come together. Hachname lo tzricha de naful, bezo achar zo, nafla chada, chalas la ruven, nafla idach, chalas la shimon, nafla idach, chalas la hai, which is ruven, mafka, zikato. So therefore the zika is no longer ban, chalas la hai, shimon, mafka, zikato. Ve'amar rav en zika. So, but rav told us that it's no zika ban between the yavam and the yavama. So he said, "Ledivrei haomer yesh zika kama." So Rav followed the other view, the one who said that there is a zika bon. So he's for himself, he holds that there is no zika bon. But here, even you have a deficient chalitza, but one brother released the yavama from the entire family. Ushmuel amar choletz echad choletz lekulam. One brother can do for all. מיכדי שמין על שמואל דאמר חליצה מעליה בינן דאמר שמואל, so he talked that the חליצה need to be the highest level, the superior, which means that if you have three brothers, two of them married to two sisters, and each one of these two, they have another wife, so two brothers that married past the two sisters with the co-wife, with the rivals, the tzarotahem, they come before the third brother. So he said in this situation, 27, חלץ לאחיות לא נפטרו צוות. So even he released to two wives, the צרות, the rival, the co-wife, they are still not exempt. So since the reason that it's because אחות זקוקתו, so he did חליצה, so therefore they are prohibited to do ייבום. And therefore the tzarot also cannot do yibum, because it's considered tzarat achot zukukato. Hei chade kaima. That's the way Rashi tells us. Hei chade kaima. Chalitza de Shimon, chalitza kshira chalitz la, Ruven chalitza psula. So Ruven should give her a deficient chalitza. So, because the second sister cannot do act in Yibum to Reuven, because it's Achot Chalutza, which means that he has much deficient Chalitza from the Shimon, that they have total Zikabon. That's the way Ritva explains. So they said, for sure there are Shash in different ways. Anyway, so they said, Mai Echad Choletz Lekulam Dekama. What do you mean by saying that one does a chalitza for all of them? So they said, "Ha'emtza'it." So again, I explain a lot in my book. Rashi said, "Klomar ha'shlishit," and I explain here based on the Tosfot Dibur Matchil Nafla and Rashi what exactly he meant, "Ha'emtza'it." But it means that they, in short, that after Reuven acting a chalitza to the first sister, Shimon specifically needs to do chalitza for the second one. And therefore, since one of them did chalitza for one of the sisters, So she is considering achot chalutza to each one of them, and since they are both equal, so each of them can do afkaat chalitza, the zikaban of the other. V'hakulan kama. But since you say that kulan, which means that all of them, so he said all of the sisters, so how can we interpret this? So one, the middle one. So he said, kevan deruba gavei, because two of the three exempt, karele kulan. So he's considered all of them. Another option, vibaitim akikamar shmul chalitza me'ale b'inanan, the middle niftach. Aval mipatra nafsha, patra. But to tell me that this applies to releasing the co-wife of the widow who received chalutza, but they releasing the one herself from a zikabon to another brother, even the lower, the inferior chalutza, it's basically release her. Even they have another ach with a strong zika. The truth of the matter, that there is much more to talk, even unfortunately here I have a lot to say about it, but since we are short in time, I just want to say that those who want to read more beside of my book, they can read more on the Keren Ora interpretation and the Ramban and Tosfot as well, the Bor Matchil Mai.
Shuloim, Malachai, Shuloim, Malachai.